सहनावतु सहनोभुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमः श्रीशङ्करानन्द नमः श्रीशङ्करानन्द गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने सविलासमहामोह सविलासमहामोह ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे। Yesterday there was a technical discussion on the process of knowledge in trying to understand what is the nature of this knowledge of the self, in what way is it different from the conventional knowledge. In the conventional forms of knowledge, such as knowledge of an object which is perceived, there is a duality of the perceiver and the perceived, the knower and the known. And it was said that a typical knowledge is considered to take place in two steps, even though we do not really recognize the two distinct steps. But then two distinct steps are involved in any conventional knowledge. Like the knowledge of a part. As I said, the mind along with the reflected consciousness, or what is called chidabhasaha, or the same as the ego that goes out through the sense organ, such as eye or the ear, and contacts the respective object, such as a part, assumes the form of that object. And thus we have a thought of the form of the part. In this case, we have a part thought, or a thought of the form of part. It is called ghatakara vritti. Vritti means a thought modification, ghatakara, of the form of the part. Now two elements are involved here. One is that thought having the form of the part, and other is the consciousness that is reflected in that thought. And these two elements perform two separate functions. That thought eliminates the ignorance pertaining to the part, and the reflected consciousness illumines the part. And that is how the knower comes to know this is a part. Now, that is because part is what we call inert. It is not a self-effulgent object and requires awareness to illumine that. That's the reason why that awareness reflected in the thought reveals that part, illumines the part. Now, when it comes to the knowledge of the self, self-process is only in one step and not two steps. The self is different from a part or a cloth. In as much as part is jada inert, doesn't shine by itself, self reveals, and there is no need for the consciousness to reveal the self. All that is needed is removal of ignorance. We have to accept the fact that there is ignorance. Even though, as the scriptures reveal, I am limitless, I am free, and even then I experience myself to be a limited being, a bound person. That shows there is ignorance of the true nature of the self. And it also shows that the self that is limitless is not even opposed to that ignorance. And therefore, the fact of my being the limitless does not oppose the ignorance that I take myself to be limited. And therefore, an opposing element must be introduced there. As you said, electricity does not oppose. Light is opposed to darkness, and therefore when the light comes, darkness cannot remain. Electricity is not opposed to darkness. Similarly also, Brahman or the self is not opposed to ignorance. Only when that self gets reflected in what we call jnana vritti, or a positive appreciation that I am Brahman, that alone is opposed to the ignorance of taking myself to be ego or a limited being. So that is what we call ignorance, and ignorance is that which is opposed to knowledge, or knowledge is that which is opposed to ignorance, and therefore knowledge has to take place. And all knowledge takes place only in the mind, only in the intellect. and all knowledge is of the nature of a thought modification. Therefore it is said that even knowledge of Brahman also is of the nature of a thought modification, which is called jnana-vritti. And therefore we have to accept that knowledge has to take place, a jnana-vritti or a relevant thought modification has to take place, which will reveal the respective object. And so just as every thought reveals the corresponding object, this thought also should reveal the corresponding object, namely the self. And so a thought must take place, enlightenment as it is called, and what is that? I am Brahman, I am limitless. This enlightenment or this knowledge must take place. And since every knowledge is of the form of thought, so this is also knowledge in the mind of the nature of a thought modification. So this also we have to accept, because as until this knowledge takes place, the ignorance does not go. Ignorance persists. And this thought form removes ignorance pertaining to the self. And that's all that is necessary to do. The second step of revealing the self is not necessary, because the self is self-revealing. In case of an object such as a microphone, both the functions were needed, that the thought removed the ignorance pertaining to the microphone and the reflected consciousness revealed the microphone. In this case, the thought removes the ignorance pertaining to self. The second step of revealing the self is not necessary, because Atma is self-effulgent. That's the point here. The first step is called vritti-vyapti. Second step is called khala-vyapti. Vritti means the thought modification. So vritti-vyapti means when a thought assumes the form of the object. And phala means a reflection. Phala-vyapti means when the reflected consciousness reveals an object. In case of the knowledge of the self, vritti-vyapti is required, meaning there must be a corresponding thought form which reveals the true nature of the self. But phala-vyapti, in as much as revealing the self or the reflected consciousness, that second step is not required. This is a technical way of explaining how the self-knowledge is different from the knowledge of an object. Because in the knowledge of an object, that duality between the knower and known prevails. And it is the knower that illumines the known. Here on the other hand, this is the knowledge of the self. And therefore, the knower and known are one alone. And therefore, you do not require knower to illumine that known, because the knower, the known itself, is the nature of the knower. And therefore, the relevant thought modification that takes place is the nature that I am limitless, I am Brahman. And this idea is explained with an illustration. Uktamartham drashtanda pradarshanena vishadayati. This is clarified by drashtanda pradarshanena with the help of an illustration in the verse 93.
Chakshurdipavapekshyete, chakshurdipavapekshyete, ghatader darshaneyatha, ghatader darshaneyatha, nadipadarshane kintu, nadipadarshane kintu, chakshurekamapekshyate, chakshurekamapekshyate. Chakshurdipav apekshyate, घटादेहे दर्शने यथा यथा जस्ट एज घटादेहे दर्शने जस्ट एज फॉर द परसेप्शन ऑफ सच ऑब्जेक्ट्स एज पॉट एटसेट्रा सो घट और अ पॉट इज अ वेरी कॉमन इलस्ट्रेशन एवरीवेयर इट अपीयर्स इन वेदांत एज वी सेड ए टिपिकल वेदांतिक टीचर हु वुड लिव इन हट हैड नो पोजेशंस एट ऑल ही वुड बी नियर परहैप्स अ रेनन्सिएट एंड having maybe a couple of pairs of clothes, and in a hut, while he would have is perhaps a pot of water, you know, in which he has filled the water. And so the only illustration he has is of a pot which is lying in front of him, or a cloth which covers his body, or a room, you know, in which he dwells. A pot in Sanskrit is called ghata, a cloth is called pata, a room is called matha. And therefore, ghata, pata, matha. So these are the illustrations that you always find in Vedanta.
That's what all their world consisted of, you see. Today we may give illustration of rockets and stuff like that, or even microphones and loudspeakers and whatever. Those days, such illustrations were not there. Then there is illustration of a lamp, because that is the source of light that they have. So here he says, that just as for the perception of a part, two factors are required. One is chakshur dipo. Chakshu means eyes, of course, are required. And secondly, you also require the light. Because here in this hall, for example, had there been no light at all, then you could not perceive the objects which are present. Even though the eyes are open and the objects are there, still we could not perceive the objects had there been darkness. And therefore, for perceiving the objects, not only we require the eyes, but we also require the light to illumine those objects. So, andhakara vada ghatadi darshane, for the perception of a part, an object such as a part, which is covered by darkness, chakshudipo ubhavapi apekshyate, both the eyes as well as the lamp, lamp means the light, both are required. Na dipa darshane, however, for the perception of a lamp, what do you require? So for a perception of a part, you require the eyes as well as the lamp. However, for the perception of lamp, what do you require? Na dipa pradarshane tu tasana. However, you do not require a light of another lamp to illumine the lamp. For the perception of a part, you require eyes as well as a lamp, meaning the light of a lamp. However, for perception of a lamp, you only require eyes, you do not require another lamp. Because lamp is self-effulgent. A pot is not self-effulgent, requires to be illumined by another light. Lamp is self-effulgent, does not require another light to illumine, and therefore, for the perception of lamp, all you require is chakshu, meaning the eyes. Kintu chakshuhu ekam apekshare, kintu ekam chakshuhu apekshare yatha, just as all you require the eyes, means two factors are not required. In case of pot, you require pervasiveness by the light as well as by the eyes. In case of the lamp, all you require is the pervasiveness by the eyes. Tatha brahmani jnanashaya, in the same manner also, the self is comparable to a lamp, which is self-effulgent. And therefore, all you require is eyes, meaning that buddhivritti or the jnanavritti or the thought modification which reveals the true nature of the self. But you do not require the other step, namely, illumining that self by another, by the reflected consciousness. Because there is no duality of the seer and the seen, or the knower and the known in this particular knowledge. In fact, it is the knowledge which reveals the mithyatvam, or reveals the falsehood of the duality of the knower and the known. That the knower and the known, both of them, the truth is called the self. And so both the knower and the known resolve in which. So that is the knowledge which is the truth of both the knower and the known. And therefore in that knowledge there is no duality. Now in the next verse, just this discussion is ultimately concluded with another question. Namu buddhitadvrittinam chidabhasavaishishti swabhavyat ghatadishuiva brahmanevi phalavyaprihi balad bhavedita asamkyaha. Says in the introduction of verse 94, that nano buddhitadvrittinam chidabhasa vaishishti swabhavyat. So rule is, wherever the intellect is, or wherever the thought modification is, that thought will reflect consciousness, because it is the nature of a thought to reflect consciousness. Just as wherever the mirror is, it will reflect my face, if it is in front of my face, because it is the nature of the mirror to reflect whatever is in front of it. And so also, it is the nature of the thought to reflect the consciousness. And therefore, even in this case of the self-knowledge, when the thought of that nature, I am limitless or I am Brahman, when that takes place, even that thought also will reflect consciousness, because it is a thought. Chidabhasa vaishishtya swabhavyat ghatadushiva brahmanevi phalavyapri balad bhavet. And therefore, just as in case of the knowledge of the part, why not you say that even in the case of knowledge of the self, that phalavyapti or that reflected consciousness revealing the self, why should it not happen as it happens in the case of a part? the question is. And that question is answered in verse 94.
Sthitopyasauchidabhasah brahmanyeki bhavet param, brahmanyeki bhavet param, nato brahmanyatishayam, nato brahmanyatishayam, phalam kuryad ghatadivat, phalam kuryad ghatadivat.
Sthitaha pyasau chidabhasah. It is true that when this thought modification of knowledge takes place that I am Brahman, there is that consciousness reflected in that, because it is the nature of a thought to reflect that consciousness. But that reflected consciousness is in no way able to reflect the self. In fact, it merges into the self. The illustration is given.
Yadyapi ghatadyakar vrittivat brahma gochar vrittopi chidavasahasti tathapi naso brahmanah bhedena bhasate.
In the ordinary case, the chidavasa shines separate from the object which is revealed. In this case, however, this chidavasa, the reflected consciousness, doesn't retain its separateness from self.
Kintu prachanda atma madhyavarti pradeep prabhavat tena ekibhutaiva bhavati.
However, like a lamp which is held before brightly shining sun. Let us say the sun is shining on the midday. At that time, suppose you hold a lamp or a candle before that sun. Can that candle remain separate from the sunlight? Can that candle contribute any way into illumination of the sun? The answer is no. And similarly also, that reflected, that consciousness reflected in that thought form, I am Brahman, is there like a candle, but the self is like the bright sun, and therefore that reflected consciousness only gets merged into the light of self. And therefore, that duality completely merges, and there is no need for, there is no separate existence of that Chidabhasa. So, Chidabhasa no more maintains its separate existence in case of the self-knowledge. Just as a candle or a lamp cannot maintain a separate existence in the face of a brightly shining sun.
Ataha spurana lakshana atishaya janako na brahmani ityartha.
And therefore, it doesn't have to serve the second purpose of revealing Brahman, because it just gets totally blinded by Brahman or totally merges into Brahman.
And finally, in the next verse, concluding the discussion, it says, Nanu brahmani phalavyapti nasti vrittivyaptistu vidyate iti uktam tatra kim pramanam.
You are saying here that in case of brahma jnanam or atma jnanam, knowledge of Brahman, that vrittivyapti asti, that there is a vritti or a thought modification has to take place to reveal Brahman. Phalavyapti nasti, but then that duality between the known and the known is not there. This is what you have said in so many verses. Tatra kim pramanam. What is the source of, what is the authority? What is the authoritative source from which you derive this particular opinion of yours, that in case of knowledge of Brahman, that a thought is required, knowledge is required, but that revealing Brahman is not required, that means the duality between the knower and knower is not required. Where do you get this?
Agamha pramanam. The answer is that the Upanishad, the Vedas are the pramanam. And that is said in the verse 95.
Aprameya manadincheti, atrashrutyedamiritam, manasaivedamaptavyam, itidhivyapyatashruta.
This all occurs because there are contradictory statements in the Upanishad itself with reference to knowledge of Brahman.
It is said, yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha.
Brahman, the self, is that from where the mind along with the speech returns without reaching. Meaning, self is beyond the mind. So it is said.
And also it is said, manasai vedam aptavyam.
Elsewhere in the Upanishad it is said,
that this knowledge must be gained by the mind alone. On one hand, the Upanishad says that Brahman or the Self is beyond the mind, and mind has no reach. At the same time, the same Upanishad says in a different place that Self or Brahman is to be known by the mind, because all knowledge has to take place in the mind. Wherever it is beyond mind, and still it is to be known by the mind. So these two contradictory statements mean what we have just said. That what is meant when they said that Brahman must be known by the mind, and what is meant when it is said Brahman is beyond the mind. So that exactly is that it should be known by the mind, meaning there should be phalavyapti, and it is beyond the mind, meaning it should be known by the mind, meaning there should be vrittivyapti, and that it is beyond the mind, meaning there is no need for phalavyapti. This is explained in the Tika here. There is an Upanishad. There are many statements, but here a statement is quoted from one Upanishad called Amrita Bindu Upanishad. Nirvikalpa manantam cha hetu dushtanda varjitam aprameya manadin cha yajnyatva mucchate buddha. Says the Upanishad, describing Brahman, what is it? Nirvikalpam. That is devoid of all the vikalpana. All the vikalpa, meaning devoid of all the projection, devoid of all the kalpana of the knower and the known, devoid of all the divinity. Brahman is that which is devoid of all the divinity, which is not available for any kalpana or projection. Anantam cha, and that is anantam, which is devoid of any anta or limit, meaning which is limitless. Hetu dushtanda varjitam. Brahman is there with incomparable, and therefore there is no dushtanda, there is no illustration. Usually, dushtanda illustration helps you to describe an object which may be similar. For example, if you want to describe, there is an animal here called bison. That bison looks very similar to a buffalo. So if we have to describe to an American what is a buffalo, we would say buffalo is like bison. Or if you have to describe a bison to a person in India, you would say bison is like a buffalo. Because buffalo is comparable to bison, therefore it is an illustration. However, there is no illustration by which we can describe Brahman, because hey, drishtanda varjitam, there is nothing comparable. For example, if you want to describe ocean, there is no illustration at all. If you want to describe space, there is no illustration at all. And similarly also, if you want to describe Brahman or the Self, there is no illustration, meaning there is no comparison. There are different ways to describe. How will you describe this? Since there is no drashtanta or illustration, how will you communicate this? Hetu, another way to describe is hetu, by giving the cause or by giving the evidence. For example, there is smoke on the hillock in the front of you, then we can say that since there is smoke, there must be fire, because wherever the smoke is, there must be fire. Then smoke becomes a hetu, or becomes an evidence to arrive at the presence of fire. Because smoke is the effect and fire is a cause, and therefore they are invariably related, associated with each other. Where the smoke is, fire must be. Where the fire is, smoke need not necessarily be. But where the smoke is, there fire must be. And therefore, when we see the smoke, we can infer the presence of fire. But Brahman cannot be inferred, because Brahman is not cause, nor is an effect, nor is associated in any way. It is not a part of an assembly, or it is not an effect, or it is not a cause, and therefore there is no hetu, or there is no evidence for Brahman. Therefore also Brahman is, it cannot be inferred. It cannot be illustrated. Can it be perceived? Is it available for direct perception? Aprameyam. Aprameyam means immeasurable, meaning which cannot be prameyam, which cannot be measured by any organ of perception, by eyes, ears, or whatever, and therefore it is beyond perception. So it is beyond perception, it is beyond inference, it is beyond upamanam or comparison, meaning not available for any conventional means of knowledge. The conventional means of knowledge at our disposal, first is pratyaksha, perception. And we can perceive that which can be encompassed by the organs of perception. That would be called prameya. Prameya means that which is known, or which is perceived. When sometimes an object is not within the range of perception, then it can be known by inference, like the fire, which we don't perceive, but we infer from the presence of smoke which we perceive. Sometimes the object may be remote, in which case it can be known also by comparing by drishtanta, just as a buffalo can be known by the illustration of bison. Upamanam, that's another means of knowledge. Shabda or the words, description is another means of knowledge. None of these means of knowledge is applicable in case of Brahman. It is aprameyam, it is immeasurable, it is beyond the comprehension. Yajñātvā mucchare buddhaḥ. That verse says interestingly, that is nirvikalpam, devoid of any vikalpa, devoid of any kalpana or duality or projection, or devoid of any kind of a doubt or whatever, anantam, which is limitless, which cannot be inferred, hetu, which cannot be illustrated, drashtanda varjitam, aprameyam, which cannot be perceived because it is immeasurable by organs of perception, that which is such, yajñātvā mucchare buddhaḥ, knowing which the wise man is liberated. Look at this, knowing which Brahman, the wise man is liberated, but which cannot be known anyway. Aprameyam is that which is immeasurable, which cannot be brought into comprehension by the available means of knowledge. Knowing that Brahman, the wise get liberated. So there is unknowable, knowing which the wise get liberated. On one hand you say it is unknowable, and then you say, but you should know it for getting liberated. That looks like a contradiction. So if this mantra says, Brahman is what is Shrutya, Amrut Bindu Upanishada, Aprameya Shabdena, Idam Phalavyapti Rahiti Muktam. So what is meant when it is Aprameya, meaning immeasurable? It means that Phalavyapti, or the second step, where the perceiver illumines the perceived. That kind of way, which involves the duality of the perceiver and the perceived, that kind of knowledge process is not here. And therefore it is said, aprameyam. You can call an object prameyam, an object that is perceived or measurable or known by the means of knowledge, when you, the perceiver, can perceive it through a means of knowledge, where there is a duality between the perceiver and the perceived. Such duality cannot be between I, the knower, and the self or Brahman. And therefore it is called aprameyam, meaning that this knowledge is devoid of the duality of the knower and the known. And therefore it is said, it is beyond the mind. Because whenever mind is employed in the process of knowing, there is always a duality between the knower and the known. Such duality not being there, it is said, Brahman is beyond mind. But it should be known anyway, in order to gain liberation, because merely Brahman being free doesn't give me the benefit of freedom. Even though I am free by nature, I don't enjoy the benefit of the freedom unless I know that I am free. It's like a treasure which may be hidden in the ground, all right, and therefore I may be a millionaire. But I do not know that I am a millionaire, and therefore that treasure is of no use to me, and so also limitless I am. But until I know I am limitless, that knowledge, that being limitless, is of no practical use to me. And so it is necessary that I should know myself to be limitless, then alone I become free. But saying that Brahman is limitless, saying that it is immeasurable, saying that it is beyond perception, it is meant that this is a knowledge which is devoid of the duality between the knower and the known. But then Upanishad also says, Manasa evedam aptavyam neha nanasti kinchana. Manasa eva idam aptavyam, idam brahma manasa eva aptavyam. If Brahman has to be known, manasa eva by the mind alone. Neha nanasti kinchana. Iha kinchana nana nasti. Iha meaning Brahmani. In this Brahman, there is no duality at all. There is not even the slightest duality here. Meaning whatever duality we perceive is mithya or false. And therefore, from the absolute standpoint, there is no duality whatever. And that Brahman which is totally devoid of duality, that Brahman, manasa eva idaptavyam, it must be known by the mind indeed. So it should be known by the mind, and still it is beyond the mind. And so it is explained that it is a beyond the mind which is impure, but it can be known by the mind that is pure. So mind that has this likes and dislikes, mind that always colors its perceptions, mind that is prone to projection, that mind can never know the self. However, when the mind becomes pure, meaning it enjoys that samadhi, shatka, sampatti, shama, dama, uparama, tiriksha, which doesn't project, which doesn't have likes and dislikes, which is totally objective, by such a mind, Brahman can be known. And how can it be known? It will be known without involving the duality of the knower and the known. And therefore, that statement which says, Manasari Vedam Aptavim Dihananastu Kinchaneti, in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, in the Katha Upanishad, where in both the places the mantra appears, Dhivyapyata Shruta Vritti Vyapyatvam Shrutam Ityardaha, that shows that Vritti Vyapyatvam, meaning a relevant thought form, should take place to reveal the true nature of Brahman or true nature of Self. And so there must be a knowledge, but a peculiar knowledge that doesn't involve the duality of the knower and the known. So far as the discussion of the nature of aparoksha jnanam or the immediate knowledge. Now we go back to where the discussion started. The very first mantra, the very first shloka of this particular chapter was Atmanam ched vijaniyad ayamasmidi purushaha kimichan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvarayad. Atmanam ched vijaniyat. If this person knows the Self, which is limitless, which is Brahman, so if one knows the Self, which is Brahman, and ayamasmi knows it immediately, then kimichan kasya kamaya, desiring what? Kimichan kasya kamaya, for the sake of which desirer? Shariram anusanjvarayad. That one will follow the afflictions of the body, meaning there will be no afflictions at all, because there is no desire, there is no desirer. In the wake of this knowledge of the true nature of the Self, the very desirer resolves, and therefore there is no desire also. And therefore there is no need to invite or to follow or to suffer the afflictions of the body. Meaning one becomes totally free from any kind of suffering. There is what is called atyantika dukkha nivrittihi, or a total cessation once and for all of all the suffering. This is what the first verse said, and this first verse was presented as the theme of the whole chapter. When the author takes up the different aspects of this verse and elaborates ideas contained in the verse. Now coming back to that verse, it is said, Atmanam chedvijaniyadidhi mantrena aparokshajnanam shoka nivrutyakhyam jivagadam avasthadvayam abhidhiyatayidhi uktam. That mantra which formed the first verse of this chapter said two things. The first line said that the aparoksha jnana or immediate knowledge. The second line said that there is a shoka nivritti or a total cessation of all suffering. And this was said also in the verse 48 of this chapter. Aparoksha jnana shoka nivritti akhe ubhayime avasthe jivage brute atmanam chedite shrutihi. That this particular shruti talks about, there are seven stages described, of which two stages are described in this particular verse. There was Ajnanam, and there was Avaranam, and there was Vikshepa, then there was Paroksha Jnanam, Aparoksha Jnanam, Dukkha Nivritti, and Ananda Avapti. The seven stages were described in typical knowledge of a wise man, of which this particular verse talks about the two stages. And what are the two stages? The aparoksha jnanam, immediate knowledge, and dukkha nivritti, cessation of all the suffering. And all this discussion took place earlier. And so, you also say, the question is, that to ask to this author, that you also said in the verse 48, that of the seven stages, this particular mantra describes the two stages. Tatra kiyata amshena aparoksha jnanam uchyate. Of this verse, which part of the verse talks about the aparoksha jnana or immediate knowledge, and which part of the verse talks about the cessation of suffering, you please tell us now. Idi akankshayamaha. If this akanksha or the question is, then the verse 96 answers that question. Atmanam chedvijaniyat. Atmanam chedvijaniyat. Ayamasmiti vakyatah, ayamasmiti vakyatah, brahmatma vyaktimul likhya, brahmatma vyaktimul likhya, yo bodhasso vidhiyate. atmanam chedvijaniyat ayamasmi iti vakyataha. As I said, this is the section of the same verse. Vakyataha, by this particular statement, atmanam chedvijaniyat ayamasmi. Atmanam meaning the self. Chedif vijaniyat, one comes to know. How? Ayamasmi, this is it. This is I. Thus one comes to know, this is I, this Brahman I am. In this manner, if one comes to know the self, by that vākyataha, brahmātma vyaktimullikhya yobodha sahabhidhiyate. Brahmātma vyaktim satyādilakshana brahmābhinna pratyagātma svarupamullikhya vishayikritya. Ullikhya means vishayikritya. Yobodha jāyate. That knowledge which arises, this knowledge which arises, which knowledge reveals that brahmātma vyakti. Brahman is what? Satyadirakshanam, satyam jnanam anandam brahma. And brahma abhinna pratyagatma swarupam. That brahman which is satyam jnanam anandam, meaning truth, awareness, limitless, that brahman, alone is the self. And this is the knowledge that is revealed by this particular, this is the fact that is revealed by this knowledge. So, satyadirakshana, brahma abhinna pratyagatma swarupam ullikhya. Ullikhya means vishayikritya. Brahma abhinna pratyagatma swarupam. Pratyagatma meaning myself is in fact Brahman. Thus, this knowledge reveals the oneness or the non-duality between the self and Brahman. What is Brahman? Satyadi lakshanam, satyam jnanam anantam. This is the lakshanam of Brahman. And this knowledge reveals that I am, that Brahman is my very self. That there is no distance at all, or there is no duality between Brahman and I. So this knowledge which reveals the non-duality between this of self and Brahman. Yo bodha jayate brahmaham asmi. What is the nature of that bodha? What's the nature of the knowledge? Brahmaham asmi. I am Brahman. Iti saha abhidhiyate anena vakyana ityartha. This particular vakya, the first line, reveals the aparoksha jnana of the immediate knowledge, which knowledge reveals the identity between Brahman and self. And which knowledge of the nature? Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. Meaning that first line of the verse reveals the aparoksha jnanam or the immediate knowledge. Now, a different turn, the discussion now takes a little different turn here. While talking about aparoksha jnanam or immediate knowledge, now the author says that this knowledge may be firm knowledge or the knowledge may not be firm knowledge. The point that is being made in the subsequent discussion is that this knowledge, I am Brahman, I am limitless, does not become a firm knowledge or abiding knowledge just in one exercise. That even though the student may be prepared, and the teacher also is a competent teacher, and the teacher unfolds properly this Mahavakya, this major statement, a great statement, that thou art. And your student sees this fact, meaning he immediately recognizes this self is limitless, I am limitless. And that is called aparoksha jnanam or immediate knowledge. But even when this such a knowledge has taken place in the process of shravanam, which shravanam is nothing but listening, which is the vichara or the inquiry, which is in the format of listening, even then that aparoksha jnanam or immediate knowledge is not necessarily firm. And therefore, it may be necessary to again and again expose oneself to this teaching. Again and again expose the mind to this teaching and listening, so that in course of time, the knowledge becomes firm. And so, that point, now what are the obstacles between which come in the way of the firmness of the knowledge? What are the obstacles by which the knowledge does not become firm? Of course, the first obstacle is ignorance by the knowledge, because the knowledge is not there. But even after listening to the scriptures, when the ignorance is basically removed and I have come to understand, then also that knowledge does not become firm. Therefore, to make that knowledge firm, to assimilate that knowledge, what is required? That is what is being discussed now in these subsequent verses, and therefore a very important discussion and very relevant discussion. And that discussion is commenced by a question. Nanu tarhi purvoktaritya sakrit vakya vicharadeva aparoksha jnana siddhehe. If, as you said, in so discussion so far, sakrit vakya vicharadeva if merely by exposing oneself to the listening of the scriptures once, when the teacher unfolds that Mahavakya, unfolds this Mahavakya once, and the student exposes herself to such a listening, aparocha jnana siddhe, you said earlier that, by the which whenever when the Mahavakya or this statement of the Upanishad is properly inquired into, this Mahavakya is tattvamasi, that thou art. And when the teacher unfolds the meaning of what is that, meaning of what is thou, and meaning of what is art, so when this Mahavakya is properly unfolded by the teacher, then the paroksha jnanam or immediate knowledge should take place. Merely by listening that thou art, the knowledge does not take place. But that particular statement must be properly unfolded, elaborately unfolded, so the student can see what is meant by that, Brahman, what is meant by Tvam or I, and what is meant by the identity between them, Asi. So question is, if by one exposure to this listening of the Mahavakya, if a paroksha jnanam or immediate knowledge takes place, then what's the need to keep on listening to the scriptures again and again? Well, elsewhere the teachers have said, avruttihi asakrit upadeshat ityadau, asakrit upadeshat avruttihi. We find that the teachers in the Upanishad reveal this Mahavakya or this knowledge again and again. Even that Upanishad called Chandogya Upanishad, the sixth chapter of which is the most important section, which is of the nature of a dialogue between the teacher and the student, Uddalaka and Shvetaketu, where we find this Mahavakya, Tattvamasi, that thou art. This Mahavakya is found in Chandogya Upanishad, in sixth chapter, which is in the form of a dialogue between the teacher, Uddalaka, and the disciple, Shvetaketu. There the teacher elaborately unfolded and then said, Tattvamasi. Aitadatma vidam sarvam tat satyam sa atma tattvamasi shvetaketo. He shvetaketo, you are that which is the essence of the whole universe, which is the truth of the whole universe, that you are. And then shvetaketo says, okay, but revered sir, may you please say that again in order to make my understanding clear. And the teacher again illustrates that by another illustration. And then Shvetaketu asks another question. Again the same vakya is illustrated. In this manner, we find that the teacher Uddalaka teaches this 9 times. So 9 times this Upadesha, the teaching instruction Tattvamasi is given in the Upadesha. Therefore, the teachers think, Badarayana or Vedavyasa, who has written Brahma Sutra, which Brahma Sutra has given us, you know, an insight into the Upanishad. He says that the fact that the teacher Uddalaka gave this instruction 9 times, that shows that avruttihi, that one must also listen to the Upanishad again and again. If merely one instruction were enough to remove all the doubts and vagueness, then it would not have been necessary for the teacher to give the instruction 9 times. The fact that the teacher in Chandogya Upanishad imparted the instruction 9 times, that shows that every student, even after getting the aparoksha jnana or the immediate knowledge, must expose herself to this teaching again and again until that knowledge becomes firm. And that is a very famous sutra, Avruttihi Asakrit Upadeshat, Brahma Sutra 411. So, ityāda vihitam śramanādi āvartanam anamuṣṭheyam syāt. Then this śramanādi āvartanam, meaning this repetition of śravanam, repetition of the listening, which is what is enjoined or which is what is stated in that particular sutra or aphorism, would not be required if merely one listening could give us the firm, firm aparoksha jnana or immediate knowledge. Iti āśaṅke jnāna-dārdhyāya tad-āvartana anuṣṭhānasya āchārehi abhītattvāt anuṣṭheyameva. The author says here, jnāna. And mananam and nididhyasanam, this must be performed again and again and again until this knowledge becomes firm. And that is what is said in the verse 97. Why not we request them to stay unless they want to attend the class? Otherwise, we should request them to stay away, otherwise it disturbs the class, you know. Narayan? About 10 minutes. Then we'll have the aarti. So verse 97 says, Astu bodho parokshotra, Astu bodho parokshotra, Mahavakyat tathapyasau, Mahavakyat tathapyasau, Nadrudashravanadinam, Nadrudashravanadinam, Acharyaih punariranad, Acharyaih punariranad. Astu bodha aparoksha atra. Atra brahmatma vishaye. Okay, in this subject of brahmatma vishaye, meaning in the subject of the knowledge of identity between Brahma and Atma, Mahavakyat aparoksha bodha astu. Mahavakyat by the listening to the Mahavakya, meaning such statements as Tattvamasi, Sakrut Sutat, Vichara Sahitat. When that Mahavakya, that thou art, when the student listens to that, as unfolded, properly unfolded by the teacher, aparoksha bodha astu, let the aparoksha bodha or the immediate knowledge, let it take place. Meaning, if the student is prepared, it is likely that at the very first exposure to the teaching, that immediate knowledge may take place, which also is a rare occasion, by the way. To have a student who has a prepared mind, and that one exposure to this teaching will create an immediate knowledge, if it happens, that's also itself is great. Suppose that happens. Astu meaning bhavatu evam, let it be so. Tathapi na drudaha nasau drudaha. Even then, in all likelihood, that knowledge will not be drudaha, will not be firm. Ataha shravanadi avartaniyam. And therefore, this listening must be performed again and again. Meaning, one must continue to expose oneself to this teaching until the knowledge becomes firm. As I asked this question, when you are digging the well for water, how long should you dig until you get the water? In between you may get some minor sources of water, which water may arise, you know, you may get it and again it may dry up. You must dig until you get a permanent source of water. And similarly also, this shravanam, listening, must be performed, and also mananam, reflection, and nididhyasanam, the meditation, must be performed as long as necessary until the knowledge becomes firm. Srimad Shankaracharya hi punah vakyartha jnanotpatyanantaramapi shramanadi avartan abhidana nityardha. Even Shankaracharya also said in the commentary of the sutra that we just said, that jnanotpatyanantaram, even after the knowledge has taken place, shramanadi, in order for the firmness of the knowledge, it is necessary that shravanadi avartanam. Avartanam means repetition. Shravanadi, the three means are there, shravanam, mananam and nididhyasanam. Shravanam meaning listening. Mananam meaning reflection upon what I have listened to. And nididhyasanam is assimilation of what I have learned. So by shravanam, by listening to the teacher, I get the knowledge. But then, there may be several doubts. There may be various doubts. Because when my own mind presents variety of doubts with reference to what I have learnt. And also, there may be various contradictory opinions by the other thinkers, which also create number of doubts in our mind. And therefore, that knowledge must be made free of doubt. This knowledge that I have gained as in the process of shravanam or listening to the scriptures must be made free of doubt by what we call mananam or reflection. And thus by shravanam and mananam we gain the knowledge that is free from doubts and vagueness. We have a clear knowledge. But still a third obstacle remains, which is called the viparita buddhi or the opposite or the false notions. That's because of a habitual error. That habitually I have been taking myself to the body, I have been identifying with the body and the mind, and therefore taking that body and mind as I, that habit continues. And as long as that habit is, again the knowledge does not become firm. What happens, in spite of a clear knowledge, again and again those emotions take hold of us, the reactions take hold of us, meaning this body and the mind with which I have been identifying from the time beginningless, again and again that takes hold of me, and therefore there is as though a forgetfulness of this knowledge. And so this knowledge should become as firm as presently I have the knowledge, I am the body. How spontaneously, if you want to say, or effortlessly, I present myself as a body. So effortless when this knowledge becomes, then alone it is called Dhradjnanam, of firm knowledge. And until then, this effort must be continued. Shravanam, Mananam, and Nididhyasanam. Nididhyasanam means meditation, meaning the alertful observation of this and assimilation of this knowledge. That what I have understood really becomes my life. Like we understand the value of truth. When it is explained to us, what are the advantages of truth and what all we come to lose when we compromise the truth, suppose it is very well understood. But still, if I am in the habit of telling lies, then when the occasion comes, habitually I tell a lie. And that habit must be overcome. I must assimilate this particular value. And similarly also, this knowledge must be assimilated until it becomes part and parcel of myself, until it becomes spontaneous knowledge, effortless knowledge. And that is called dhrada, or firm knowledge. Until this knowledge becomes firm, one must continue this effort. That's the idea. So jnana-dardhyaya etetat arthad labhyate. That why, for jnana-dardhyam, meaning for the firmness of the knowledge, this effort must be continued. And acharyahi kena vakyena abhitam vyasankya tadvakyam patati. Whereas Shankaracharya said this, that you must repeat or must again and again expose yourself to this. Whereas the acharya said this, tadvakyam patati, that very same verse is repeated here from a text called Vakyavritti. So Shankaracharya, we referred to the text earlier, where 8 verses were quoted earlier also. And here again, a verse is quoted from the text called Vakyavritti. And it's that forms the verse 98 of this text here. Aham brahmeti vakyartha, aham brahmeti vakyartha, bodho yavad drudhi bhaved, bodho yavad drudhi bhaved. Shamadi sahitastavata, shamadi sahitastavata, abhyaset shravanadikam, abhyaset shravanadikam. Aham brahma iti vakya artha bodha yavad drudhi bhaved. This vakya, aham brahma, I am brahman, iti vakya artha bodha, until the main knowledge of this particular statement, until it becomes drudhi bhaved, until it becomes firm. Stavada, so long, shamadi sahita abhyase shravanadikam. Until then, one must do the abhyasa, one must keep on repeating shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam. This must become part and parcel of every seeker of knowledge. Constant study of the scriptures, listening to the scriptures from the teacher, reflecting upon what I have listened to clear up all my doubts, and an attempt to assimilate that knowledge again and again, so that I overcome this, what we call dehadu buddhi, or this habitual error of taking this body as I. Samadhi sahitaha. And that must be accompanied by a particular frame of mind, which is called Samadhi. Shama, Dama, Uparama. So these also values must go along with the pursuit of knowledge. Shama meaning the quietude of the mind. Dama meaning a self-control over the sense organs. Uparama means withdrawal from all unnecessary activities. Titiksha means the forbearance, or the forbearance of forgiveness and forbearance of whatever inconveniences or discomforts there are. Shraddha, an implicit faith in the scriptures and the teacher. And Samadhanam, single-pointedness of the mind or single-pointedness of the pursuit. Along with this, one must pursue the Shravanam. Otherwise, in spite of listening 100 times, the knowledge doesn't take place because this frame of mind is not there. So this Shravana meaning listening to the scriptures, etc., becomes effective only when we possess that kind of a mind which has the right disposition, which is described by Shamadhi Shatka Sampattihi. So there Shankaracharya says, Shamadhi Sahitaha. One possessed of this frame of mind, that such a student must pursue this Shravanam, Mananam, etc., again and again, until the meaning of this Vakya, Aham Brahma, becomes firmly rooted. Okay. Now, how that is being discussed, that we'll see next time.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Vadarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadhyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namah Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om.